today for our grand opening of our demonstration garden. This garden could not be possible without the folks that you see up here, as well as a few other volunteers and our park staff. So we are very excited to have them up here today to share with you how you can take some of the ideas that we see in our native plant garden out front and translate them into your homes. So first we have Andy Spirka. From CIGCI. We also have Ken Owen from Channel Islands Restoration, Amanda Shepherd from CSUCI, and Kelly Green, who does everything. She is representing the Ventura County Master Gardeners today. So we will begin.
Do you want me to start? Okay, so as we said, this was a collaboration project with Channel Islands University students, mainly the ESR program, Environmental Science and Resource Management. We worked with Channel Islands National Park with the basically we wanted to create a native sustainable garden that everybody could possibly recreate at home. So this is a progress of how we made the project, and how we made the garden look good. So this is basically the first site, what it initially looked like. It was very overgrown with a lot of native plants, a lot of lemonade berry. So it's very overgrown.
So we started the project in December of last year is when we first started to create our plans for the project. And in January to about three months, we started to do proposals for the project with the Park Service back and forth to come up with our idea on how to redo what you see in front of us. We wanted to have not so much, as you can see, the lemonade berry got pretty high, blocking their window view out to the ocean and everything. So we just wanted to redesign it so we could really highlight some features they wanted.
So can I say something about that?
Oh.
My volunteers as Master Gardeners, we manage this site and we do the garden, but we never managed that. That was just, the water didn't work, it was too many rocks, it was too rough, it was like the wild garden. So this is just wild, and we just gave up on it, it was just too much. But it always bugged us that it was so unkempt, and it blocked the front of the Park Service and the visitor center, and it was not even really interesting anymore. It was just a lot of lemonade berry. And basically it was the rocks. It was just so many rocks that we didn't do anything in there. So it was really time for a change, and it was all these things coming around, and Andy and Amanda just stepped up, and this was like, because I knew that I could not do that. There was no.
All those rocks you see out there, we didn't even bring new ones in. We actually just reused everything we found and just found a way to make it look nice, really, that way.
Yeah. A lot of moving. Okay.
So we have different steps on how we went through it and everything. So this is one of the first plannings that we did. We actually came up with a whole little 3D outline of the garden. We drew up, as you can see, a CAD image. And there's also another plan with flowers in bloom that we were able to choose different colors. So you could see throughout the year, we were able to show them what the actual flowers were going to look like in different parts of the garden. And we actually created different zones of the garden too, so that we just wanted to demonstrate all these different ways that you can plant with different kinds of plants and different species.
Yeah. So this was the second step. So construction started during summer, because that's when we had most of the time to give without having issues with conflictions with classes. So a lot of digging was done and removing rocks. As you can see, we had to use a forklift sometimes because there was a lot of big rocks, and a lot of help happened with Sammy, who's part of the National Park Service, who helped us move rocks and stuff. So mainly we first started with making a pathway. As you can kind of see there, you can kind of see the pathway. Do you have anything to say?
And then, so as you can tell, we didn't have to go to the gym for a while. We got to move a lot of rocks in and out, so that was a great day. We had a lot of help from volunteers too, which was really killer, from local, from Channel Islands students who needed community hours, and then other people who stepped up to the plate to really help us move these really massive rocks out of the way before we can even plant, because you need to have a good amount of underneath ground to be able to actually have the plant thrive and live, instead of just put it right on top of a rock with some soil around it kind of thing.
So the next step we did was we did a rain collection system because we wanted to be sustainable and try to collect as much water as we can without wasting water by watering plants with a system. So we basically made a French drain where we dug a hole or a trench along the edge of the building, and then we put a 12-inch diameter pipe system into the ground with a lining to help filter out any dirt or soil that went into the pipe to keep the water clean. And then we connected it to a rain system barrel at the front. You can kind of see it, and it has a pump in it that will pump the water out through the drain or the piping system into the pond that we made.
And once that pond actually we created as the main water feature, and you see the dry seasonal riverbed on the side, that's actually supposed to be dry most of the year, and when we do get high rain events, it's just supposed to be an overspill and overflow area for that water.
So the next step, like Andy said, is we made the pond. So we actually lined it with liner because the soil here actually soaks up everything, and we wanted to kind of make sure it stayed there so you can see how it changes throughout the years. So it will be full of water, hopefully when it's during the rainy season. It depends honestly how much rain there is. And also it will be a dry pond area for when it's not, when it's the dry season basically, because it's supposed to mimic our own natural habitat.
And we also put riparian plants along the water corridor because that would be able to actually soak up and absorb the water and use it in a more water-wise way. So this is our actual seasonal riverbed with water we pumped into it right here, just to be able to see if we actually created the elevations correctly, because we had it sloping down the entire way and then have it pulling at the very end.
Yeah, so the whole, you can fill up the river and the pond with the use of the pump. So it is possible if you want to run it, you can run it and have it fill up.
And one of the best parts that, which we've already had happen with having a pond such as this, is that you're gonna have birds coming into it, local birds and stuff hanging out. It's like a big bird bath, really.
Mm-hmm.
And it just looks really nice, actually.
Yeah, it was, I think one of the greatest parts was once we made the pond and we filled it up with water, you could see the birds come, because we never actually had birds come to that area. So it was really nice to just see that and see that the birds were using the stuff we put in. So the next step is we actually paved and lined the path. And this was really mainly done by the collaboration with the Santa Monica Mountains Restoration, Trail Restoration, I think it was.
Trail crew.
The trail crew, yeah.
Yeah.
Because they are experts at this stuff. They know how to make trails. So we had them come by and help us make this. It was a really interesting process.
As you can tell, we keep using the rocks in a way where we actually take up some space and use them as accents instead of just putting more and more plants out there. So it really helps with water usage on that end also.
So the next step, what we did was drip irrigation. This took quite a while. So if you really want to be accurate and have your plants have a good system of water flow, you should do drip irrigation, but I will warn you, it takes a long time. So these are the main lines. And then we had little, the bigger, thicker tubing is the main lines for water flow. And then we have smaller spaghetti tube that went out from the main line to each base of each plant there. And then we monitored how much water would go to each one. So we had a gallon for more water.
Yeah, the ones that, the woodier perennials, the chaparral plants, the riparian plants, they have they get more water. And then the ones that, so the plants that are out towards the flagpole, that's the area that gets hit really hard by wind and sand and salt. And if we have a winter like we had a few winters ago, it will be full of sand again. So we'd have plants that can handle all that coming in. And so they are more desert oriented. They can handle that type of situation. So they get less water, so we want to overwater them. And we also have the beauty of drip, and so it is, Amanda's right, it's a lot of work to put it in and plan it out, but you just do it basically once. Unless you make a mistake, then you have to correct that. But we have shutoff valves, we have micro shutoff valves, we can really customize it, we can have plants that these are all being watered, but these are not. And it's very creative. And we have water to each and every plant, so there's no waste of water. So the idea is not to have like what a sprinkler does, where it runs onto the sidewalk or into the street, but the water goes right to the plant. Mm-hmm. And so that was the goal, to be very efficient.
And you can customize how much water goes
yep.
to each plant because
yep.
the different emitter will put out a
right.
different.
We have half gallon, 1 gallon at different rates. We could go up to 2 gallons if something is needing more. We can change that, and it's very, very customizable. It takes time to lay it out and figure it out, and we have to know where the plants are, where they're going, and all of that.
And you're not wasting all that water too by showering on top. You know,
no.
that water's really staying below that bark or mulch or whatever you put there, and really soaking into the ground itself,
yeah.
allowing
yeah.
for the roots to take it up.
And especially if you have mulch, it keeps rock or gravel, chips, whatever your mulch is, it keeps the moisture in so you can do less watering.
And it's also on a timer, so you can
yep.
set when you want it to water and for how long.
Yep.
But you can always get different timers and stuff.
Right, it's very creative. There's lots you can do.
And then throughout the garden, we have these actual tidbits of information that we put up. So like some of the drip irrigation is exposed, so you can see how that's actually done and created. Most of the time it's a buried irrigation. But Kelly actually made a good point, is run your drip irrigation before you bury it, so you actually see where stuff is, where there's
yeah.
holes, or else that's gonna be a long process
yeah.
to fix. So we have signs throughout the entire thing that are little tidbits of information how you can do this in your own garden. And it's really just helps to actually bring home the message that, you know, you don't need to hire a professional to do this. You can actually do this, get it done, local materials. It's and we also have Amanda created a web PowerPoint
yeah,
website.
It's not done yet, I haven't had time, but I'm gonna be creating a Esri story map, which is basically an interactive blog area where I will follow the whole progress of the project, and it'll have information of how we made the garden, so dimensions, price, stuff like that, information about where you can get this stuff, like materials, what kind of plants we used, and then those plants will have pictures and they'll relate back to a map that will show the actual extent of the plant and where they occur in California. So it won't be done until I think April or May.
Yeah, a few more months.
Yeah, and hopefully it will go on the Park Service website. Hopefully they'll put it up there.
Yeah, they are.
They'll have to be approved.
I'm on to
that. Okay.
Yeah, I appreciate
it. And then one great thing we used to top everything off was mulch. It really helps to conserve that water usage too, while also providing a really like nutritional supplemental thing for the
yeah.
plants over time. And it's a great touch on any garden too.
It's also a good cover to cover over your irrigation. So if you can't
amazing.
Cover it, you can just put it with that.
And you can get local mulch in the local area too by different companies that will be able to mulch up local trees
yeah.
and everything like that. So you make sure you're not introducing anything new to your garden that you don't want.
And I don't think you need to replace it very often.
You probably do like every couple of years.
You need to
re-fluff your mulch.
And I think inches.
Yeah, so you don't want to ever do more than 6 inches, and you probably ideally should have 3 inches. We couldn't do 3 inches here, we just didn't have the space, but the beauty, so this is very sandy soil, it's a lot of sand and not a lot of nutrients in the soil. So the mulch will break down, and with the dead leaves and the things with the plants, we're gonna start making more soil. So it'll enrich in what we have there. So maybe in 20 or 30 years, it'll be a whole different thing.
Yeah.
Does the mulch stop wildfire from?
It does, it can't. You'll still get weeds, but you get much fewer weeds. And it's hard for them to root into. It depends on how fine your mulch is or how chunky it is. But it does help. And you can use rock and gravel as mulch too. That works really well. But yeah, it helps a lot. I've used mulch for 30 years and I have incredible soil.
Yeah, one of the reasons I haven't is because I'm worried about having wildfires.
If you want to do like wildfires from seed, so mulch can stop that. So you will want to expose soil so they can germinate, but then you have weeds coming up with that, so
sure.
it's a trade-off.
Yeah.
Or you could just grow the wildflowers, and then put them in
okay.
among the mulch and do it that way.
Okay.
You can do that.
That's what I actually did with my own garden. I did it that way, and actually the wildflowers did
yeah.
come up, the ones I wanted at least.
So we were actually going to do questions after. We're almost done.
We're almost there, though.
But another thing to note, when you're planting, you really want to make sure the best time to have all your plants in the ground is the first 2 weeks, I think, of October, because that's when the rainy season starts. So it's less time and money and resources to water your plants, because you're just doing regular rainwater. So this is the final product. After a long year of working on this project, it turned out really good, we think.
I mean, it took us a while. It took us about 12 months from
yeah.
inception to now. But I mean, that is also doing with the public agency, going back and forth. So I mean, you're doing your own garden. You're the boss. So that's not gonna take us long. But I think as long as you're patient, though, I mean, like some of our biggest tips is just, you know, be patient with it. Take your time. If you really want a good final product, actually think about what you want to put in there and really just enjoy doing it, too.
And you'll also have to be patient because it won't look that great, I think, until maybe a year when you mm-hmm. let the plants grow in and take up space and actually flourish and let them bloom and stuff. So
yeah.
You have to wait for them to grow.
Well, that's the case with most gardens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
cool.
If we have any questions.